Hi everyone, I'm Jayne from Rack and Worms. Tonight we're going to be talking about prepping our breeder bin bedding. Why do I always pick things that are hard to say? I don't know. But we're going to work on the bedding tonight because on Sunday is my 21-day cycle and I'll be pulling out my breeders and I want to have my bedding ready to go, ready to receive them. So I like to do it a couple days ahead of time. That way I can make any adjustments to the bedding that are necessary as I go along. But sometimes I forget and I make the bedding the day of, and that's fine too. But anyways, before we get started with making the bedding, I want to take you into one of my breeder bins that I will be sorting out on Sunday. And the reason I'm taking you into this is because it's going to give us information that we can use when we're making the new bedding. All right, I'm rolling this back quickly. Can you see the worms? They are diving down away from the light. Oh, look at this, guys. Look at cocoon here. That's a good size one. Another cocoon here. Another cocoon here. This is great. This is the first time I've been in this bin in probably 10 days, and that was only to do a light sprinkle of worm chow because I made a new batch and I had some extra. So I just put it on the top of my breeder bins. You can see they've eaten it too. It's not here, which is a good piece of information to have, which means I can, I'm gonna put this over here for a second. I can add a little bit more worm chow into my bedding mix. And I'll talk about that when we get to that part in the steps. Because they're eating it all. Okay, now the other thing I'm looking for is leaves. Okay, you see the leaves here? There are leaves, but there's not like huge chunks of them. And I want to see how much the leaves are breaking down in the breeder bin. Because that signals that the biota is working. It also signals that the worms are eating them. Look at these guys. Oh my God, they're beautiful. All right. Again, normally you wouldn't disturb your breeders, but I'm going to be disturbing them on Sunday anyways. And I thought you'd like to see them. I know I do. So it's a sacrifice of a couple days that I'm willing to make. There's more cocoons in the bedding. Okay, well, I could look at these guys all day. But what we're going to do is we're gonna put them back. And, oh, I know, the other thing I wanted to look at, I almost forgot, is the presence of the orange microbial bacteria. My patio bin of pre-composting seems to be at a temperature that the orange, maybe, see right over here? Can you see that? Yep, there it is. That's orange microbial biota. And my bin seems to operate at a temperature that it makes this orange stuff. So when I put the bins together, and you'll see a little bit of that tonight, you're going to see a lot of the orange biota in there. But I'm not seeing a lot left in the compost bedding. God, look at all those cocoons. Man, this is great. This is what you can look forward to. So anyways, not a lot of the orange microbial left, so that means again they're eating it, which is food source. Okay, we're gonna close this back up. I'm gonna just smooth it out. Now one last thing before I put this away and we move on to the bedding mix is one of my viewers commented, Miss OP was her handle, and she had asked me if I baited out my breeders. Okay, which basically means putting in some sweet food that they really, really like, and it will draw them to the food, and therefore, when I go to remove them to put them into the new breeder bin, I'll have a whole bunch of worms all together. It makes it faster, easier. Historically, baiting is done in grow-out bins, okay? It's a type of vertical migration or horizontal migration. But like I said, it's normally done in grow-out bins. I haven't seen anybody do it in a breeder bin, so this could be a first time. You're seeing this live on video. So I'm just going to put this in, and I'm not going to bury it on purpose because I want to see what the worms do with it. Okay, so that's that. So let's close this back up, get them back to being calm and happy, and maybe they'll crank out a few more cocoons between now and Sunday. Okay, let me get this out of the way, and then we're going to make their next bedding home. Okay, this is a standard bin. It's a little dirty because that's what I had the top of the breeder bin in. Okay, the formula is I'm going to use 1 gallon of sifted cow manure. Now, you may not have cow manure. Fine. You can use coconut coir. You can use peat moss. Both of those work just as well. You know what? The other thing I'm going to mention to you while I'm in here, see all these little white pieces here? That is just unprocessed grass that is coming out of my cows. Okay. Some of my viewers had said on one of the videos, oh, I saw a wisp. And I hope you did, but it's just as likely what you were seeing was a little piece of this undigested grass. Okay. So the next thing that's going to go in is a light gallon of crushed up leaves. The reason it's a light gallon is because that's all I had prepped for tonight. And I'm working on actually figuring out how to get more dried crushed leaves for my bins. I live in Southeast Florida. Deciduous trees are not very plentiful here. So I've got to figure out how to make my own dried leaves. So I'm working on that, and I'll tell you about that some other time. Okay, the last dry ingredient for all intents and purposes is a gallon of the pre-composted bedding from my outdoor patio bin, which is the combination of two of my indoor pre-composting bins that got to the kind of the stable state. And in order for me to have more room to work in inside my ormery slash front room, I put the contents of those two bins in together into a larger outdoor bin, but it's the same contents. Now, one of the things I will say, I'm gonna start mixing this dry stuff up a little bit. One of the things I will say is because my smaller indoor composting bins got combined and put into a larger bin, I was able to add some more carbon and some more nitrogen, and it had more mass significantly with the two bins put together. Okay, that's just generally mixed up. I'm going to interrupt myself. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to add water. This is room temperature, maybe a little bit on the warmer side. Again, one of my viewers, and I'm sorry, I don't remember who it was. She said that she found that if she uses warm water to mix up her bedding, she finds that it mixes more easily. So, a lot of times my water is a little bit on the cooler side, but this time I tried to make it a little bit warmer. Okay, so where was I? Oh, yes. So because I was able to add some more carbon and nitrogen to the outdoor bin and have more mass all in one place, that temperature did start rising again, and it does get hotter than the smaller pre-compost bins ever will. And that's what gives it the temperature rise that allows it to generate that orange biota. In my smaller pre-composting bins that I'm doing this series on, my maximum temperatures are around 113 degrees. And I don't get the same type of biota developing. So just keep that in mind. If you're making smaller bins, you're going to get different biota and they're going to be different colors. And some of those colors you're not going to be able to distinguish out of what you're seeing. Okay. I am going to, I think, add in just a little bit more water. Okay, I thought my cameraman was signaling me something there, but he wasn't. Okay, I'm going to add in a little bit more water. So let's talk about the water and the moisture for a minute. Breeders like very moist bedding. Not soppy wet, but very moist. So we want to add a generous amount of water. And I can't emphasize enough that it is water. If you have chlorinated water, you need to dechlorinate it. You can, you know, put it in a jug or a container, let it sit out for 24 to 48 hours. And the chlorine, will dissipate. Okay. Oh, I have a whole dry pocket here. Seems to be an ongoing theme with me to have dry pockets. So let's mix through this. Okay. Okay, even if this is, you know, quite wet, you can see it's quite wet. The materials I put in are very, very dry. So I have every expectation that tomorrow when I double check this, all this water has been absorbed and I'll probably need to add even more water. So just keep that in mind. If you're able to make your breeder bedding ahead of time, that it'll probably need more water. Now, if, like I said, you don't have the opportunity to make your breeder bedding ahead of time, don't worry about it. Just make it when you can. And if you end up having to go back into the breeder bin the first, you know, 2 days to add more water to make it a nice, very moist consistency for the breeders, do it. Because what you want to do is get the breeder bedding as optimal as you can. So going forward for the next 21 days, you don't have to disturb them, or you disturb them very little for very short periods of time. Like if you decide to, give them some molasses water misting, for an example. Okay. All right, you get the concept, right? I still have dry pockets, but I'm going to go back and get those. And again, it will hydrate and absorb that water over the next 2 days. Okay, now what I'm going to do is I'm now going to add my amendments into my breeder bin. So they also have a chance to get distributed, do any water absorption, so they're all ready for when the worms come in and hit the bedding. So what I'm going to add is 1 cup of my pre-made worm chow. Now, this is what I'm adding to my bin with the 1 gallon of the cow manure, the 1 gallon of the leaves, and the 1 gallon of the pre-composted bedding. For the amount of worms I'm anticipating that I'm going to put into this bedding. I don't actually know exactly how many worms are going to go in yet because I have to see what's in the breeder bins. I have different numbers of worms in different breeder bins. Okay, now 2 other things, actually 3 other things I'm going to add. The next thing I'm going to add is some azomite. I did an unboxing of the azomite when I bought it because I had never used it before or had it before. I didn't know what to expect. So if you're interested in that, please check out that quick video that I made on unboxing with the azomite. And the azomite is more for the worms to start breaking down, so it has a chance to become bioavailable to your plants more readily when you finally get to use your castings into your garden or to your potted plants. Oh, excuse me. The next thing I'm going to do is just give a generous sprinkling. And this is agricultural lime, and it works both as a buffering for pH, and I also heard that it works as grit, but I don't know for sure on that. So to make sure I do have grit in here for my worms, this is powdered eggshell. And actually, powdering the eggshells is something I just started doing because I was putting eggshells into my brooder bins and my grow out bins, but I wasn't powdering it. I was just pulsing it. So it was, you know, small, very small, but distinctly pieces. And I was talking to a group of very serious, knowledgeable wormers, worm people the other day. I think it was last week. And they were talking about the powdered eggshells. And I was like, oh, I haven't been able to get my mix, my blender to do the powder. And they said, try again. So I did. And what I found was you have to have just the right level in your blender, you know, just over the blades, but not too far over the blades. And you'll get that nice eggshell powder. Be careful not to breathe it in. What I do is I blend it and then I let it sit with the lid on for several minutes, and then the powder kind of, you know, settles down. All right, this is looking good. All right, that's really it. So I've got the bedding components of the cow manure. I'm sorry, my cameraman is giving me a hint on something.
Sorry, everybody. How much azomite did you add?
Oh, good. That was a quarter cup of azomite. Thank you. Now, let me again say this is for my size bin, which is about 2.5 square feet. And your bin might be larger or smaller, and you need to adjust your amount to fit your bin as well as the number of worms you're putting into the bin. More worms, you need more bedding. You also need more amendments, more food, more azomite, more grit in your eggshells if that's what you're using. Okay. All right, so this is pretty much ready to go. I'm gonna close it up. Oh, you know what I also wanted to do before I went, and I remembered this myself, my cameraman didn't have to remind me, is I'm giving a quick spray of molasses water. Why I'm doing this is I'm feeding the biota that has been in the manure, has been on the leaves, and in the pre-composting that may be a little bit on the hungry side because they've been, you know, in storage for a little bit. So that molasses water will be enough to get them kind of awake and activated. But I don't want to add too much because I'm not composting this. I don't want it to heat up. I just want the biota alive and working. Okay, so the last thing I'm going to do is put on my newspaper. I can spray this also with plain water, so it'll help drip in additional moisture into the bedding over the next day, and it'll also be, you know, nice and moist and soft in case any of the breeders, when they hit the bin, decide that they want to eat newspaper instead of worm chow or biota or cow manure or whatever they do. They get a smorgasbord of food in order to help them concentrate not on eating, but on breeding. Okay, so the last thing I'm gonna add is my plastic bag. And we're all set. Okay, so one last thing as a reminder is this bin is 95% ready for the breeders. It is not 100% ready for the breeders because I'm going to go in the next 12, 24, 48 hours before Sunday and check the moisture level. I'm gonna add more water if I need to. If for some reason the bedding is still like soggy wet, which would be surprising because it's not soggy wet right now, but just say it is, then I would have the opportunity to mix in more of my dry ingredients, the cow manure, the leaves, or the pre-composted bedding. And the last thing again is to remind you, if you don't have something I'm using, there's perfectly great substitutes like coconut coir, peat moss, black cow that you can buy in the store might be an option. I don't personally know that much about the black cow. I do know people use it, but read the back and see if it's something that can work for you if you don't have other sources of bedding material. Okay, so that's it. Thanks again for joining me. Please comment below. Let me know what you're doing with your breeder bin bedding. And like and subscribe. And I'll see you probably on Sunday or Monday when I do the sorting of the breeders and putting them into this new bedding. All right. So you have a good night. Take care. I'm yours in the dirt, Jayne.